First of all, how many of you work on retail or indirectly work on retail? All right, good showing. Hopefully those who doesn't, I'll share some insights and draw some curiosity. Those who are working on it, hopefully this will fuel some ideas and generate some partnership, okay? There we go, oops. There you go, agenda, of course. First, we're gonna talk about, what's the change? What's the change? We all know that retail landscape is changing. So I'm gonna kind of share with you sort of my thoughts on what those changes are. And what are some of the fundamentals that we need to focus on in terms of driving retail excellence? And beyond that, what is the future for retail? First, a little bit about myself. I was born in Taiwan, but I grew up in Southern California, Surf City, and trained in graphic design typography. That's where I landed in Hallmark. And then basically worked my last 20 years on retail because in terms of brand building, I think that's where the rubber hits the tarmac, with the biggest impact. And also the reason why I gone to retail is also as a designer, I'm always curious. I'm always curious, why am I designing? Why am I designing for, and who am I designing for? Okay, and I think the retail space offer a lot of sort of rationale and approaches, okay, to get the result. Prior joining L'Oreal, I was in Asia. I was in China for 6 years, and then 3 years in Singapore. Really just learned a lot about shopper marketing, shopper-based design insights, and working with across different retailers, as well as a research firm like Ipsos, and learn how to conceptually sell the design solution based on insights. And I myself have gained a lot of knowledge and also experience. And this is why I want to share back to you guys. Okay. My current role is with L'Oreal Paris, based in New York City. So Rich, if you want to drink anytime and talk design, give me a ring. Today, L'Oreal is perceived as sort of the leading beauty expert, simply because we have the best product innovation across the board. And however, we're not perceived as the retail expert. And go-to-market is obviously critical to grow the business and building the brand. So my role is really just think about and leading that whole retail elevation change for the US market. And it is quite complex. This is the sort of the US landscape, not just the world, but Think about the 60,000 different stores, store types, channel types. It's very different from one another. Changes. First thing, brick and mortar is not dead, okay? It is actually doing very well, okay? I think there's a surge of e-commerce and digital, yes, but the bulk of most industry and most businesses still rely on retail. Okay, I like to see it as we live in a very exciting time. Think about last century, turn of century of the Industrial Revolution. We literally live in a digital and retail revolution today. Okay, so it's more of glass half full than half empty. Okay, so there's a lot of opportunities here. And yes, it's a brand new retail world, okay? Given the different expectation of the shopper, this consumer segment change, technology, come into play. So this is a very big opportunity and we need to capture it. Case in point, cashless stores in China, this whole cashless society, Walmart using robot to organize shelf, okay? AirDrop, okay, for Amazon. And not just that, but also experimenting with different types of retail format, okay? Starbucks, the coffee roastery, that they just launched that in Milan and also Shanghai. And they're not only building the brand, but also gaining a lot of learning from these experiments, what I call. And Nike has been doing this forever. You know, back in the day when I was at Ford, we have collaborative projects on learning from Nike when they first established Nike Town on how to improve auto dealerships. You know, that's where we kind of co-partner on that. And we see a surge of pop-up events, pop-up stores across the globe. Okay, data shows that there's, you know, 50% increase on brands and also business investing in product as opposed to stationary stores. Okay, and a lot of these are really homing in. If you were to kind of filter everything out, it's really about creating, leveraging brick and mortar to create education centers, classes, clubs, providing entertainment, doing shows, and lastly but not, you know, connecting with online gamification. So a lot of things are happening right in front of us. And more CEOs are understanding that you can't just talk about your brand. You have to do. You have to create activities, okay? Activities that's either faster and cheaper or interaction with thrills, okay? So it's a balance of both. Because she today have choices. She has choices. She have more choices in terms of products. She have more choices in terms of channels, you know, even store types to go to. The same shopper, her expectation on these stores or the channel is different. Okay, when she is going to buy cosmetic in Sephora, her expectation of going to Walmart to buy cosmetic is very different, okay, as the same shopper. So we have to understand, number one is our core brand equity to her, what is that perception, okay, before we ever involve or invest in the retail transformation. First transform your brand image, then consider transforming your physical space. And on a micro level, we're seeing that the traditional department store are closing down. Okay, I think, you know, we all know that, right? In US, Sears just filed bankruptcy. I mean, it was like century old. They're the one who first started the whole department store revolution. So, and more department stores are closing down, facing traffic issues. And more traffic are going to more assisted self-serve store type, like Sephora, like Ulta, and really just creating this whole personalization and really customization experience that really delights the today consumer in the future. And even on the micro level, we did some research and data in terms, what she really is looking for is not just to acquire the product or get a discount or promotion. She needs to feel good, okay? She needs to feel good not only in terms of having to interact with the product, but she feels like when she step into the store, it's an escape for her, okay? When she's in the particular category or zone of that's your store, mass retail store, she feels that she's in a different world. How do we create that sort of immersive experience, if you will, from a sensorial standpoint? But the good news is, globally, 20% women are spending more on beauty, okay? Women, they have the wallet to buy. However, the issue is that 51% are changing where they buy. Okay, there's no loyalty. Loyalty is gone. Okay, the yesterday of, you know, my family just spent the whole weekend. I still remember this when I first migrated to U.S. You know, Sears was the place to be. You know, that's where the family spends their whole weekend. You know, just like hanging around, looking at different things. I still remember that, hanging around the malls. But now, there's no loyalty anymore. She can go anywhere, okay? Oops, there you go. So the retailer reinvention must give shopper more reason to come and stay. How do you get her to stay? How do you hold her? Not so much about closing the deal. You want her to stay, the longer she stays, the more likely you close the deal, the more likely she will revisit, okay? Now, coming back, there are some fundamental that's obvious, but yet it is hard to break because we work in an industry that's been here for decades, okay? And we collaborate with our retailers, okay? This landscape change and shift definitely impacts everybody, okay? So in that, what are some of the fundamentals that we need to fix? This is what the typical mass retail today, you know, at least in the US, I believe, you know, in China is a similar case, you know, where you have different categories, abundance of products, you know, with price tags everywhere, you know. So and this is, in particular, this is a, you know, sort of cosmetic shelf, you know, yes. Lots of opportunities here. In L'Oreal, what we promised to ourselves and our consumer is that we want to build a more intimate connections with our customer and at a point of sales and that's unique experience that play, educate, aspire, and discover. Okay, so prior to that is sell, sell, sell. So now it's all about experience. And through that, we did a sort of deep dive with our supplier and partnerships. And there's really two sort of big buckets of it. It's the human dimensional experience and the contextual context, okay? In terms of the human, it's about relationship, it's about making connections, it's about building that social connection and community. How do we leverage retail space to do that? Not only online, okay? And activities and interaction, how do we provide more tools, okay? Physical tools where people can interact, okay? Why can they play, why can we test the products? Why can we customize the products? Why can we create the product at a point of sales, okay? In the mass retail space. From a more contextual, it's physical and content. Where do we show up? How do we show up? Okay, we're looking at different destinations. Case in point, you know, like Union Square in New York City is very popular with college students. That generation is the future of our consumer. So how do we show up as a brand? You know, beyond just in Target, beyond just in CVS or Walgreens or Walmart, you know, how do we show up? What kind of activities that we can create to excite her, to get her attention of our brand, right? And lastly, more structural and operational, this has to do with data. Data is key. Through those interactions, how do we gather important data to fuel our next wave of innovation, retail innovation? And also, this is something that we never talk about. You know, we always see consumer as consumer, you know, who pays, but we never see her as a shopper. So we're creating these sort of through the deep dive, through the interactions, we have defined, you know, sort of the 8 design principles on how do we attract her attention, how do we enable her to really engage with our brands in a physical brick and mortar store. And this is sort of our universal strategy, which is, I can't talk more about it, but I can guarantee you that is very, very shopper-centric. case in point, collaborating with our key retailers on creating a total destination within a very complex environment, starting with the total category, down to the brands, and actually flow to the products. And going beyond, transforming a more task-based and room-based approach to a more occasion and trend-based. You know, how do we invest and focus more on key holidays? You know, Valentine's Day. How do we hook on these whole athleisure trends? Connecting with that. It's key to connect with her emotional aspiration. how do we drive adjacencies? Partnership with fashion retail. May not be global brands. Could be local. Could be fashion boutiques. And also, again, investing a lot of pop-up events, creating the buzz and social, okay, to get the word out. Not so much about just sales. And this is some of the success that we've done across the globe. This particular one is a color lab that we partner with Watson's in China. Okay, so you get the idea, right? And also we continue to strive for breakthroughs, okay? Creating things that purely based on hypothesis, just like what Mark at Google said. Test and learn. We never know that it's gonna work or not until we test it, right? And different destination, possibly. And early this year, L'Oreal have announced their investment in terms of technology, okay, at the Viva Technology Fair in Paris. Okay, our commitment, because we really believe that there's intricate connection between technology and beauty and fashion. Okay, acquisition, Modiface. So we have acquired Modiface just now, and then we're looking at how do we utilize this. We're experimenting. I myself, we're kind of involved in this project of testing it in different retailers, because let's face it, not every mass retailer really are ready for this type of technology, because her expectation may be different. Digital path to purchase, you know, not just from a brand standpoint, but how does it impact the total category? How do you lead her with the different digital tools, you know, at different touch points in the store, from a signpost to the tablet, okay, to even like, shelf talker indicators. You know, how do we utilize the different technology in different areas of the store? That needs to be find out. On top of that is the content. What is the right content? The same content that Sephora's leveraging in their store may not work, may not be appropriate, you know, in our mass retail. And the different tiering of activation, this is just another example in terms of content. Future outlook, as things are moving in a lightning speed, you need to anticipate not the next quarter, not next year, but 3 years out at the minimum. So how, what do we're looking to, you know, collaborate with some of the trend insiders, create, you know, looking at, you know, what could be potentially happen. In this case, we know that 5G is coming, 2020. I think some China's earlier. I think they already are incorporating that. You know, the impact on 5G from 4G to 5G. You know, a lot of these driverless cars, okay, hologram. You know, there's hologram. You know, you have a meeting with people who's not there. That's all going to happen. It's going to be the reality. And in talking with some of the tech giants, you know, just, you know, from workshops, you know, like our cell phone will be obsolete pretty soon because you don't need to carry your cell phone with you anymore. It's wearables, your glasses, your watch. It's part of you. It becomes part of you. That's going to be the pretty soon the reality. And here's a little sort of snippet of potentially this could be the case.
Bueno, por otra vez.
So advancement of AR and VR will transform how we live. Okay? And there's a lot of the tech giants right now, they're working with Hollywood producers on creating these virtual world. And it's all, by the way, it's all choices. She can actually turn this thing off. She didn't want to be bothered with it. That's it. Okay. Thank you.
Buen día, Emilio. ¿Qué puedo hacer por usted?
And by 2020, more than half of American under 18 will be minorities. Hispanic accounts for almost half of U.S. population growth, and by 2040, Caucasian will be the minority in the U.S. What is the implication on that? You know, culturally, religion, you know, will Christmas still be the biggest holiday in U.S., or would it be Cinco de Mayo? You know, who knows? Or is it Chinese New Year? So how do we, as a brand, how do we respond to that? You know, how do we prepare for that? And globally, I think Muslim also is another white space, okay, in terms of purchase power. The third is brand centricity. Again, it's no longer about selling. It's about social responsibility and purpose. In the case of L'Oreal, we're an advocate of woman and worth, okay? Not so much of, you know, female leadership in business success, but more of her contribution, her impact to society and community across the world. And how do we celebrate that? How do we encourage that? Okay, so that is sort of our mantra and our sort of brand purpose, if you will. And in summary, what can we expect is retail and brands needs to redesign their assets to live on multiple tech platform and surfaces. Okay, we know that 5G is coming, so are we prepared? Do we have the capability? Do we have the resource to generate the type of content to meet the advancement of technology? Retailers and brands need to work harder to comprehend new ethnic majority and their values. Okay, understanding not just the majority, but also the minority starting now. Okay, lastly, retailer and brand needs to continue to embed their brand values into the economic value chain at local level for growth. Not so much at a global, because we're so fragmented in our world. I think you have to win your region first before you take on the world. Thank you very much.